In 1970, I developed a, what's called a phase-locked loop oscillator. Microwave is a microwave oscillator that was phase locked to a very stable reference. Referred to it as a PLL. I won't go into how I happened to do it, but I did it on my own. I did it in my basement for a company called REL that was located in Long Island. I lived in New Jersey at the time. But Long Island was about a 2-hour drive. I built the unit, and there's a picture of it. Now, they were in the business of point-to-point radio. That is, a radios which would transmit a microwave signal from mountaintop to mountaintop, one point to the other. And this was one of the key elements in it, something called an up converter or a down converter. And there's a diagram here of an up and down converter. Mm-hmm. And basically, they feed in a low frequency signal with the modulation. You mix it with a PLL, and you come out with the sum and difference. And then you pass that through a filter, you amplify it, and then you shoot it out across the valley to a receiver that uses just the opposite technology. So anyway, these guys, the engineer's name was Paul Gruber, who took a liking to me, and so did some of his engineers there, because I supplied a number of these units to them for their point-to-point radio. However, the synchronous satellite business was just starting to get off the ground. Now, synchronous satellite, it's like a rock at the on a end of a string that you twirl and you go around and around. Satellite is up about 22,000 miles, and at just the right speed, and it has just the right pull from Earth to equal that of the gravity pull to keep it right in at that distance, and it will track the Earth. You engineers probably know all about how synchronous satellites work, but they were just being introduced into the satellite business. As a matter of fact, the first concept of synchronous satellites was developed by Hughes Aircraft Company. You probably never even heard of Hughes Aircraft Company, because they kind of went out of existence, or I would say were bought out by bigger companies and lost their name. But back during the World War II and afterwards, they developed missiles, very accurate radar-guided missiles, and they developed the fire control systems that were in the airplane. It was a very forward company, and they gave me a scholarship when I graduated from VMI to go to the University of Southern California for my master's degree. I worked for them for 2 years while I went to USC. They paid for that fully. They also had me work for them 20 hours a week, which was very interesting. And they gave me a tremendous opportunity. I'll just mention that. The group that developed the synchronous satellite, they assigned me to work with those guys. They were a very interesting group of guys. Hughes Aircraft Company was started and owned by a guy named Hughes, Howard Hughes, who was a very erratic kind of person. But he had Mormons that worked for him because he only trusted Mormons. So this group I worked with happened to be Mormons. And every noon, they would have a prayer session. And I didn't get involved because I wasn't into the Mormon religion at the time. But interesting thing is that because I worked with that group, They gave me an assignment, and that assignment was to develop a voltage regulator of very small and size and weight. And at that time, a voltage regulator used big transformers. Well, I developed this using switching transistors, which made it a very small unit, very high efficiency. And this was one of the first units that first regulators that flew in the first synchronous satellite. So I had some connection with that business, although now we move forward to the talking about the PLL, and that's no relationship really to the synchronous satellite, except similarity is that the way you communicate to a synchronous satellite is the same way that the point-to-point radio works. It still goes from point A to point B. It's just instead of going across a valley or some 30 miles, it goes 22,000 miles straight up to a receiver that receives the signal, then retransmits it back down to Earth. So this PLL finds its usefulness in that kind of system also. So at REL, there were a bunch of great entrepreneur engineers, and they left REL, and they all started their own companies in Long Island, building the equipment for synchronous satellites. So they all needed PLL units, and since I had a relationship with them, they came to me to build their PLLs. And each one had a different design, required a slightly different PLL unit, and therefore, we had to work to make little design changes to accommodate each of the companies. So when you have a satellite system that transmits TV, phone data across the country or to other continents, they have to interface with the television stations, with the phone companies, with the data centers. So how do they do that? Again, the little picture here shows a depiction of that. So they have microwave links that now go from the satellite terminal out to the TV stations, to the phone companies, to the data centers. And so each of those requires several PLLs. As a matter of fact, in these terminal centers, which have these huge antennas that are about three stories high, and you've probably seen them driving down the freeway in the countryside. A satellite can handle anywhere from 25 to probably 75 channels, depending on what traffic they're handling. So each of those channels requires a PLL. So in these terminals, you will find hundreds of these up and down converters, and each one of them has one of these PLLs. So you can see with the need for satellite and for the direct to the users, there were a lot of them. So anyway, so that's kind of how I got into this business. Now, with that said, they encouraged me to start my own company, which I did. And they provided me with orders and with some money up front to get the company started. So I built that company up over 18 years. We expanded. Initially, we started basically myself, and then I hired a couple of assemblers and somebody to supervise the assemblers, and then a couple of engineers, technicians. So we grew, and over 18 years, we grew and had to make three changes each time into larger and larger buildings. And here's a picture of what the building was at the time we sold it. I sold it. So at the time that we sold it, we had about 200 people employed. It's a lot of hard work. You work many hours because you are the guy, you have your life savings into this. Unless you're fortunate enough to have some investors with deep pockets, then you work hard to please these guys and to keep your job. But when you start it yourself, as I did with just a little bit of money, you work day, nights, weekends to get this going and to build it up. So that's kind of a synopsis of my company, which was called Communication Techniques Incorporated, or CTI for short.